kernel, call kernel book. My major focus is on locking and control group. So, and one project that I've been recently focusing on doing is about CPU isolation. So this talk is about the progress, the journey that I went through, and also the progress that we have made so far in the area of CPU isolation. So what is the CPU isolation? Basically, if you run a certain workload like the DBTK, which is a workload that used to handle a lot of network packages, those applications have a very strict requirement in terms of the latency that they allow, as well as the performance. So you have to be as quick as possible, as much throughput as possible, and without too much latency. To do that on a linear system is a challenge. The reason why is a challenge because when you run a kernel, the kernel itself have to constantly do some background or housekeeping activity to keep all the resources that they manage in a good optimized condition. And to do that, you have to constantly do things like reclaiming memory and also flushing dirty data out to the disk. So they are constantly doing some kind of background work to, even though when there are nothing, no application is running, they still need to do some of the background work. And because of the background work that they are doing, they use some of the CPU time to do it. And in other words, they are stealing cycle from the application in order to do this. And when you are stealing cycle, it means that it introduces additional latency. And it also reduces the performance or the throughput a little bit, depending on how much work the kernel need to do. And the purpose of the CPU isolation is to shift all this or most of the housekeeping work to a small set of dedicated CPU that does all the work for the whole system, while freeing the rest of CPU to focus on to run the user application. Because you allow those housekeeping work to go on the CPU that run the application, it will introduce additional latency as well as reduce the throughput a bit depending on how much work it's going to do. And you may ask, maybe we can use a real-time kernel to ensure that the latency, to ensure that we have good latency. But the thing with real-time kernel is that a little bit higher performance overhead. And because of that, just using the real-time kernel itself, although it may solve the latency problem, in terms of throughput, it still can't reach the throughput that some applications demand. So in many cases, we couple a real-time kernel with the CPU isolation work that we are doing to achieve the best of the both worlds. And depending on the application you're running, sometimes you can run it with CPU isolation, you can run it without using the real-time kernel also, and which can improve the performance a little bit. So in the past, the way we do CPU isolation is by using some kernel option. Before that, when you compile the kernel, you have to make sure that the kernel have the no host full configure option enabled, which allow CPU isolation to work. Without that, some of the CPU isolation feature may not work, and so you cannot achieve the best result. And there are two major kernel options that you can use to enable CPU isolation. The first one is isolcpus. So it gives you a flag and also the list of CPU that should be isolated from disturbance. Sometime later, people introduce a no-hertz full kernel option that does additional isolation. I will talk about the different kind of isolation that you can do within the kernel in the later slide. But just keep in mind that these are the two major options that you can use to do CPU isolation. The thing with static isolation is that you set it up at boot time. So when the kernel boot up, it statically set up CPU to be isolated from kernel disturbance. And that's it. You can't change it at one time. So the problem with that is if you want to change it, you have to change the kernel parameter as well as the reboot the kernel, which can be costly in a production environment. So what exactly is the housekeeping CPU need to do? There are a few areas that the housekeeping CPU had to do some background work for to surface the whole system. There are a number of timers that you need to manage that expire at a certain time and then trigger some event to happen. And then there's the RCU, the weak copy way, weak copy update technology that are in the kernel to help speed up processing without using the log. And with RCU, you are actually delaying some work until later time to do it. And those delayed work has to be done eventually. And this is what the RCU callback processing need to do. And then you also have to manage the tick, the timer tick. So all the operations, all the linear operating system had to define what we call the clock tick, the hertz configuration option. For well, it's 1,000 hertz. And for some other kernel, some kernel use 250, some even use 100. If the hertz is 1,000, it means that every 1 millisecond, there will be a timer interrupt that trigger the tick handler to do all the tick handler work, like the update the time, the system will report, and so on. And then there is a domain here mean schedule load balancing. The scheduler in the kernel need to load balance the different tasks to optimize their usage in the system. So if there are multiple tasks need to run on certain CPU, they have to time share it. But if there's some idle CPU available then you can move those tasks to another CPU. This is what the scheduler is doing. So scheduler are constantly moving tasks from one CPU to the next, and so on to optimize its usage, depending on your objective, whether it's energy saving, that means move all the tasks together in a few CPU, or in throughput computing, that means you want to have the maximum performance, then you spread out all the tasks to different CPU to utilize all the CPU available. And then there's the work queue. There are a lot of work that need to be done. Let's say that when there's an interrupt coming, the interrupt handler itself cannot do a lot of work in the interrupt context because it will block the progress of the current application that is being run. So what it usually do is it spawn what we call a work item to the work queue, and then it will run later on as a separate user task thread. And then there's an IRQ that manage IRQ. That's for certain hardware device. You can manage where the IRQ will send the interrupt to which particular CPU. And those kind of things are all, can be user configured. So there are some sysfs file you can modify to configure this. And then there's the kernel itself also has a number of background kernel, or we call the kernel thread of the worker to do a lot of they are the actual running thread that are needed by kernel to do all these background activity. Okay. The reason why we want dynamic CPU isolation is because with static isolation, you have to dedicate a set of CPU to be isolated so that it can be used in case an application that needs to isolate CPU will run. But the thing is, if you are running on system that can run a variety of different workload, and the workload mix can change over time, and if you dedicate a set of CPU to be isolated, then that means that those CPU may not be able to run some of the application. So that is essentially a waste of the CPU resources. But if you have if your system is dedicated to just one application, then that is fine. You can certainly allocate the isolated CPU and just run this single application continuously. But if you want a system that can run a mix of different applications, static isolation may not be the optimal way. And dynamic CPU isolation provides a way to isolate a CPU at one time to meet the current need. But then the degree of isolation that you can achieve via dynamic isolation is not as good as what you can do with static isolation. Because there are a number of things that are much easier to do when you're putting up a system than when the system is actually running and you have to move some existing thread or work from those CPU that need to be isolated to elsewhere. There is a lot more work. And right now, the way we manage CPU isolation is to use the new SQL V2 isolated CPU set partition as a major focus of where dynamic CPU isolation capability are being improved and being used to do CPU isolation. So the CPU set the CPU set controller on the SQL in the SQL a long time ago already have the ability to disable load balancing, which is one of the isolation that some application may require. So they don't want the scheduler to move it to elsewhere. They want to dedicate it to one on just one single CPU, and the application will run continuously, and you won't need to go to sleep that often. So in that case, you can disable load balancing by using, if you are using CPU V1, there's a control file called CPU set.sket load balance. When you turn it off, it will disable load balance if you use it in the right way. The way to use it is a little bit tricky because of the way the CPU set works. So you have to dedicate a set of CPU in a CPU set, and no other CPU set had to contain those CPU. Then you can isolate it. You can turn the sket load balance to zero to isolate it. And to do that, it also means that you have to turn off the load balance in the root SQL. But then you turn it on a child, then those CPU that are in the child will still able to do load balancing. So the fact is, so you need to load the way it worked in order to really do CPU isolation effectively. And with the new SQL V2 functionality, we introduce a concept called partition. So you can partition partition a set of CPU into a particular CPU set, which means that those CPU cannot be used in all the other CPU set, except the descendant. So, and we use that, which using this isolated CPU partition is a much easier way to use the load balancing, to disable load balancing than using the SQL V1 approach. Okay, and then there is the unbound work queue. Many kernel subsystems use the unbound work queue to process some work that need to be done in the task context, especially when when issued by a handler in either the hard interrupt or soft interrupt extent. So there are cases that you want to run something, but then you're in a context that you can't run it effectively. So you spawn what we call a work item and send it to the work queue. You will be run it later on when there are CPU available. And for the unbound work queue, basically you can run on any CPU. And to enable CPU isolation, you don't want any of the worker to use CPU in the isolated set. And the way to do it is they actually assist FSDUI to specify what CPU are allowed to run in the unbound work queue. And you can set it manually, but with the CPU set, isolated CPU set functionality, it will do it for you. So you will automatically, you will create an isolated partition, you automatically exclude the CPU from the CPU mask of the unbound work queue. So you don't need to modify things in a number of different places to achieve isolation. You can just do it in one place in the CPU, using a CPU set, and it does everything for you. And in terms of that is the status of the current upstream kernel. We are also working on providing additional isolation capability in the near future. And so these are some of the work that we are planning to do. All the housekeeping CPU are maintained in a set of CPU masks, what we call the housekeeping CPU mask. And so one of the patches that we are working on is to make those CPU masks dynamic. I mean, whenever you need to isolate those CPU, this CPU will be taken away from the housekeeping mask. Those housekeeping masks are used at one time and also at boot time. So for some of the processing, if they need to reference the CPU mask at one time, and if those isolated CPU have been taken out from those CPU mask, that means they won't run on the isolated CPU. And then there's also other work, including RCU processing and timer tick and manage IRQ, that need explicit additional code to make sure that they can be removed from the isolated CPU. And that is still ongoing, and we hope to have this work done in the near future. So in conclusion, the reason why we support dynamic CPU isolation is because it's a request from our telco customer. They want workload mainly related to network processing that require low latency and high throughput. So we need to have dedicated CPU to run those user app. And they also want to run it in system like the web-ownership container platform. And in order to do that, you can't use static CPU isolation because if they are not running those telco workload, you're just wasting the CPU. So we want to implement this dynamic CPU isolation feature in order to satisfy the telco customer. And right now, we already support it to a certain extent. As I said before, we are able to do CPU isolation, at least by disable load balancing and also some other stuff like the work queue. It's already supported in the OCP platform, but it's still not as good as what you can do. It can be done by using static CPU isolation. So we are trying to closing the gap between the two, make dynamic isolation almost as good as static isolation. And this is our goal for the for the coming year or so. I hope to we can complete that by the end of the year or sometime next year. And so that is the end of my presentation. So do you have any question?
Hi, Waiman. Thanks for the talk. It was really good. I happen to work on some DPDK and networking applications, and one issue we have is it's fixed, meaning like the application itself has a fixed core list at startup. And so even if the kernel might support dynamically adjusting or tuning this, the application itself is still kind of not there. Is there any thought to how the system might expose some APIs or like other stuff to detect that this is available, functioning, and that the application can start just using it, like, you know, from the DPDK side?
I guess the application may need to be modified in a way that they accept a list of isolcpus that you can use. If it is a fixed list, yeah, I think we can force the isolation work to just to isolate those specific CPU, but in the end, the application need to adapt in the future to be more optimized. And because you have fixed list, then you limit the system that you can run on. If your system doesn't have the, let's say you have fixed list from 10 to 20, so you need 11 CPU, but if you're running, you try to run it on a 16 core or 16 CPU system, it won't work because the extra CPU aren't there. So eventually, the application have to be modified so that you can accept the list of isolated CPU that you can use to run. But at the moment, I think. We can still manage it by forcing those CPU to be isolated if the application have a fixed set. But it's not the, but I think those applications need to be modified eventually. Okay, did that answer your question or?
Little bit helps. So with respect to containers, how would this kind of functionality be surfaced through, you know, whatever container runtime, or what is your experience with that?
It's a functionality that are already supported by OCP, at least the latest version. I think the OCP engineer have a better answer to that question.
I can answer that, actually.
Hey, so I can answer that. Can you hear me? So in the way that we did it in OpenShift is, so the CPU manager is a plugin that goes into the kubelet that basically allocates CPUs for workloads particularly. And then we have some patches in Cryo, which rely on some patches that we have added to Kubernetes for OpenShift specifically, that basically when a pod requests you know, full CPUs and is in the guaranteed QoS class, then we, like, Cryo basically sets all of these cgroup variables itself. So it is the one that, you know, once the CPU manager chooses the set of CPUs that the pod will get exclusive access to, you Cryo basically configures the pod slice and the container scope and also the cgroups above it to you know, tune these knobs basically. So it's done by Cryo in this case, the higher level container runtime.
Any other question? Okay. Thank you very much for your time. And I hope you can all learn something.